Yes, welcome and good morning, good evening, good afternoon, guys. Welcome to your next continuation of the lecture. Yeah, so today we're going to take a look at themes. Yeah, I think you're really familiar with the word themes, right? So let's take a look at the definition of a theme. Yeah, groups of two or more people. So that's the definition of a theme. You say it doesn't exactly consists of 100 people or 200 people. It's around smaller than that. Yeah, so it's more than two. It can be one person team. Then that's not a team. That's an individual. Yeah. So a team exists to have a purpose. So it needs to have an objective that it needs to achieve. Interdependent means to say that it interact and influence each other. The person inside the team. Mutually accountable for achieving common goals means everyone is accountable to achieve it, just not one person, but entire people in the organization. Sorry, in the team, in the organization. Yeah, perceive themselves as a social entity. So it's a social entity. Remember, in previous chapters, we talk about how people group themselves into groups, informal or formal groups. Yeah. So many teams, many types of teams in and informal groups. You can take a look at here: permanent teams, temporary teams, informal, formal groups, self-directed teams, virtual teams, heterogeneous teams, and homogeneous teams. So let's take a look at one by one here. Yeah. So we have the first one, which is informal group. Okay, informal group. So the reason why it exists is an innate drive to bond, social identity. We define ourselves by group members. Goal of accomplishment and emotional support. So it's not really official, it's not really something that is created by the need of the government or to need to achieve any of the organization or government idea or objective, but rather something more social, like a group of friends, a group of people in the workplace that share common interests, perhaps the same hobby or the same way of lifestyle that they like. Yeah. So informal group, as I think in class, I think you already know this, yeah. Things that are given you guys, like the group that I've given you guys, are official ones. But those people who you like to be with after outside of teams are going to be your informal teams. Advantages and disadvantages of teams. So I think this, I think you can figure out your own. This is, I think, really clear, yeah. How to minimize social loafing. So social loafing is, I think, it's normal. I think everybody's been doing this. Every time we have some discussion in a WhatsApp group, most people don't want to get involved, and that is what we call as social loafing, because you assume other people is going to jump in to discuss, or you think that your opinion or your question isn't important. So that's an issue within teams. So you can take a look at the picture here. Yeah, the picture here, there's like seven people, and there's one people presenting, and he or she is asking a question, and no, only one person is replying, and everyone else is doing their job because they believe that other people will back it up, other people will do it, not themselves. So they don't feel that responsible because the responsibility is dispersed towards everyone else. So they believe that someone is going to do it, someone is going to command, someone else is going to interact, so it's not my job. So that's what they call social loafing. Yeah. Next is a model of team effectiveness. A team is effective when it benefits the organization, its members, and its own survival. The meaning of team effectiveness, number one, you could take a look here. Yeah, it exists to serve organizational purposes, meaning to say it is functioning. It relies on satisfaction and well-being of its members, needs fulfillment. Its ability to survive, to maintain the commitment of its members, meaning to say that you are supporting each other, you are helping out each other for you guys to cooperate together to achieve those objectives. So team effectiveness model, you can take a look at this organizational team environment. Yeah, whatever environment, I think you guys are clear here. You can take a look at example there. Then we talk about it will affect the team design as well as team processes, and team design will affect the team processes in terms of what kind of characteristics, what is the team size, and what are the team's norms. All of this is going to be discussed after this. Yeah, and in the end, it eventually will affect the team effectiveness. Yeah, so all of this is the antecedent before you the precedent in order for this thing to happen, which is the team effectiveness. Next here, you can take a look at here. It's team design, as in terms of how your team is being designed under this model. Yeah. So you take a look at task characteristics. What kind of what kind of tasks are they supposed to do? What is their main objective? You can take a look at here. Learn role faster, easier to become cohesive. Ill-defined tasks require members with diverse background and more time to coordinate. Means it's not clear, so you need something that is very plain, clear towards all the member in the group. Team preferred with higher task interdependence, extend that employees need to share materials, information or expertise to form their job. Means that there's a lot of people to do that particular job because they don't know really they don't know really how to perform it better. Levels of task interdependence means how much they are sharing or require help from other people in order to accomplish it. So you have the highest one is reciprocal. So you can take a look, A relies on B relies on C relies on A. So it's a check and balance is going on towards all these parties. So high interdependency. You rely C, you for C, you rely to B as well. And A relies is giving the relationship towards B and C as well. So everyone is important. Sequential or assembly line. So A needs to do their job first, next to be followed by B, and then afterwards, and C can do their job. So it's not reciprocal. It's basically waiting for the other person to finish their job. So this, I think most people can see this in assembly line in a factory, like for creating shoes. You want to create shoes, you cannot just suddenly put what they call the sole of a shoe at the bottom first without people knitting them to the shoe. Yeah. And low means that it's pooled. So the resource person is the person is giving everything there, so they don't really interact with other people. They can just do it on their own. Yeah, so that's the lowest one in terms of the level of task interdependence. Team design feature. Next one is team size, how big it is. Yeah, the bigger they are, the harder it's to be controlled. Yeah. Team composition. Effective team members must be willing and able to work on the team. Effective team members possesses competencies. 5 C's. Let's take a look at 5 C's. Yeah. So 5 C's is cooperating, coordinating, communicating, comforting, and conflict resolution or resolving. Yeah. So if your team members have all 5 characteristics, therefore your team should be effective. Not just one, but everyone in the team. Yeah. Team composition, diversity. Yeah, team members have with diverse knowledge. So when talk about diversity, it does not only talk about like your race or your religion or your culture, but sometimes in terms of your knowledge or your skills, perspective, values, things that other people do not share as you. So that's why we call diversity in the workplace does not only contain on superficial or something that is only skin deep. Yeah. Advantages, better for creativity, solving complex problems, broader knowledge base, and better representation of teams, constituents, because it takes a look at everyone here in the organization. It takes a look at what are their capability and who has the expertise in what field or which part. Disadvantages, take longer time to become a high performing team, more susceptible to faultiness, increase the risk of dysfunctional conflict. So it means to say that people don't get along well when they are so different. I believe right now when you have your team, your assignment team, you don't really feel that comfortable to discuss because you don't really know the other person, so it gets really awkward. So if somebody makes a mistake, no one wants to tell them they made a mistake, so that it gets really awkward. Homogeneous and heterogeneous, I think, is really clear. Before this, we talked about in homogeneity as well as heterogeneity. Homogeneity means so there's one group of people, same thinking, same race, same culture, or anything, etc., but they're the same. Heterogeneous means so they're more than one, that is diverse. For instance, homogeneity, like your group members are all from KK, or all your group members are all female, your group members are all Muslim, your group members are all UiTM students. So all of those are homogeneous. Yeah. So some of it are homogeneous, some are not homogeneous, but it has different aspect of homogeneity. Yeah. So homogeneous team, it has its advantages such as it lasts conflict because people think the same way. Yeah, faster team development forms better on cooperative tasks because everyone is comfortable with each other. Better coordination because they can just ask anyone to do their job properly and they'll be okay to receive that instruction. High satisfaction of team members because if you're comfortable with the person that you are in, you probably have no conflicts with them, so they're much more satisfied. Heterogeneous teams, let's take a look at their advantages. Either advantages or disadvantages. Yeah, you can take a look at how it's given here. Yeah? So it has more conflict because you don't share the same idea, you don't share the same background, you don't share the same values. Perhaps whatever you're saying, they don't understand. They prefer it to be done somewhere else. Perhaps like because you're younger or because you're older, so your perspective is different than them. Longer team development. Perform better on complex problem because they have so many expertise. More creative because there's so many people with different backgrounds sharing new things, new ideas that probably you never heard before. Better representation of outside the team. So it takes a look at how people in the organization are coming from different cultures and different backgrounds. So team processes, stages of team development. So these are the processes of making team development. So you formed it, you storm. Need to say storm is figuring out to do something, whatever it is. Then norming, make it what is the rule, what is the normal thing to be done in the team itself. And next one is performing. And at the end, towards adjourning, means to say that the team is disbanded. It's being closed down. It doesn't exist anymore. So team building. So number one is team building. Formal activities intended to improve the team's development and functioning. Activities and programs initiated for team members. Types of team building: clarify team's performance goals, improve team's problem-solving skills, improve role definition, and improve relations. So this is what we say team building in the first place. So get to know each other, get to know whose role is doing what, who is responsible to do something or something else. So people are clear and where the authority are presented in the workplace or especially in the team. Team norms, informal rules and shared expectation by team establishes to regulate members' behavior. Norms developed through initial team experiences, critical events in team's history, experience, values members bring to the team. So this is what we call, what is your culture in the team? For instance, if there's a deadline, does everyone follow the deadline, or is it okay for you? Is it okay for you to be a bit late? So those are kind of norms. So when everybody comprehend towards this norm, adhere towards this norm, it becomes normal for them. So it needs to be your team needs to have their own normality. Okay, what is considered to be normal in the team? So you create rules that is suitable for everyone. Preventing changing dysfunctional teams norms. State desired norms when forming teams. So you tell them exactly early on what they're supposed to do, what is needed, what is their role, what is expected of them. Select members with preferred values. I think it's normal, yeah. Or discuss counterproductive norms, means what kind of normality is bad or negative for the team, such as attending meetings late or submitting their work late. Reward behaviors representing desired norms. So basically you give them rewards, positive reinforcement. Yeah. Disband teams with dysfunctional norms. So if some teams are not performing because their norms are not good, means so they only focus on the negative ones, so it's better to disband them and form new ones. Team cohesion. So I think cohesion here is something that is very solid, something that's really clear for you guys to see. Yeah, so there's team cohesionness. Yeah, the degree of attraction people feel toward the team and their motivation to remain members. Both cognitive and emotional process related to the team members' social identity, how they look at themselves to be part of the team itself. So that's part of the team cohesion. So influences of team cohesion. So how good is your team cohesion depends on these factors. Yeah, now, member similarity. Just like in homogeneous factor, so it applies to this as well. So how similar are you with your group members? Team size, smaller teams tend to be more cohesive because it's easier for them to delegate work and to be independent and interdependent with each other. Member interaction, regular interaction increases cohesion. If you don't meet your members all the time, it's gonna really get awkward. So you need to meet them so that you have that familiarity. Yeah. calls for tasks with high interdependence. So you negotiate with them, you interdependence with them, you have to do something, and they have to be the one who is there, that is supposed to be supporting you, and you're supporting them, and the other person is supporting each other. So that is what we say as high interdependence between each other. Yeah. Somewhat difficult entry. I mean to say, it's not really easy to enter your team. You have to pass like a few tasks or selection method. If people think that you're not qualified to join their team, then they don't want to be a part of it. They want to be a part of it. So because it something to be bragged on, something to be proud, because you managed to join such a very high quality or elite teams. Yeah. Team eliteness increase of cohesion, but lower cohesion with severe initiation. So let's take a look. Yeah, for certain an example here, there are certain university that is really hard to be to enter, such as Harvard or Oxford. Yeah. So when you are able to get in, you know that you really appreciate being in that university. So this can be applied towards anything else, such as a team. So some teams are really renowned for their being elite. They can perform and do things fast, and they are really equipped in their analysis, in their production of work. Team success. Successful teams fulfill members' needs. Success increases social identity with them. Okay, so I think it's really clear. Nobody wants to be renowned or with the team that is always losing. For example, your football team. Yeah, so you never won anything, and you don't want people to know that you're part of the team. But imagine if your team wins again and again, and they're really famous. So you really want to be associated with them. So you really want to be part of the member. Yeah. Team success. And external challenges increases cohesion when not overwhelming, to say that challenges that they can do, and they strive together and they help each other out. Team cohesion outcomes. So this is the fact that we can take a look at if the team is cohesive enough. Yeah. Motivated to remain members, willing to share information, strong interpersonal bonds, resolve conflict effectively, and better interpersonal relationships. I think this is all clear, right? But in case you're not clear this part, discuss in our WhatsApp group later, or contact me. Yeah. Team cohesion and performance. Already, it has these four cubes that is represented: high task performance, moderately high task performance, moderately low task performance, low task performance. So you can read this as in team norm support company goals, as well as low team cohesiveness. If the team norm support company goals but low cohesiveness, it is moderately high task performance. But if the team norms oppose company goals but low team cohesiveness, it falls under moderately low task performance. And if team norm support company goals and high cohesiveness, then it has high task performance. And if it has high team cohesiveness but team norms oppose company goals, then low task performance. So meaning to say that company goals is something what they want to achieve. What if they are cohesive but they're lazy, or if they are really what they call they really support but they don't have the cohesiveness in the team, they also don't perform much. Yeah, I think you can understand this, right? And that's the end for team, but don't click away. We're gonna continue. Yeah. Okay. So let's take a look at trust. Okay. Trust is defined as positive expectation on one person has of another person in situation involving risk. Yeah. So you can take a look at here how trust is being seen into these three levels. So you have high, low. So identification based trust, you know that person. Knowledge based trust, you know that person. Or calculus based trust, you think that they're gonna perform because you think they're gonna do it. Yeah. Self-directed teams defined. So this is a self-directed teams. Cross-functional work groups organized around work processes that complete an entire piece of work requiring several interdependent tasks, and they have substantial autonomy over the execution of those tasks. So I mean to say that these people in the group has different what they call expertise, different experiences. So they all bring their best towards in combating the challenge, combating the issue that is being faced, or the or an assignment given to them. Yeah. For instance, creating a new product. So when you want to create a new product, you need people from marketing, you need people from the R&D, you need people from the ICT, etc. So all of those are people in order to create the product itself. Yeah. Subverting team success factors. So these are the factors for them to be successful. They are responsible for entire work process. They don't really blame other people. Their locus of control is internal and external at the same time. Yeah. High interdependence with the team. So they connect with each other very closely. Low interdependence with other teams. They don't really regard of other teams. They just focus in their own teams. Autonomy to organize and coordinate work means that they are really independent. Technology support team communication and coordination means that their communication is much more faster, probably using the internet or any high-tech technology. Yeah, virtual teams, I think it's really clear, I'm not going to explain much, but I think you can understand. Yeah, virtual team success factor, technology, self-leadership skill, emotional intelligence means that they can take care of their own emotion because they don't really meet their other team members, so they get really awkward if they don't talk to other people. But if you have high EQ, yeah, emotional intelligence, then you can manage on your own because you don't really meet with other people. Yeah. Team decision making constraints. So this is what happens when you want to make decision making. Number one is time. Yeah, I think it's clear. Evaluation apprehension. Believe that others are silently evaluating you, so you don't want people to evaluate you. Just like in our group WhatsApp group discussion, you don't want people to see what's your comment or what's your idea because you think that you're being evaluated. That they think, oh, he or she doesn't have good idea. So you don't want to look stupid. Yeah, so this is one example of evaluation apprehension. You're afraid of it. Yeah, you're being pressured. Yeah, peer pressure to conform means say you have to follow other people even though your idea is different, but because you don't want to be ignored or to be seen as someone that is really outside of the team or the organization, so you just go along with everyone else. Groupthink. Tendency in highly cohesive teams to value consensus at the price of decision quality. So they don't really care about other people. So they just think as a group and largely believe that everyone should follow the same kind of mentality or thinking or decision making. So general guidelines for team decisions. So these are the few guidelines for making choices for teams. Team norms should encourage critical thinking. Yeah, as usual, because you have to understand the environment, you have to understand the why, the reason, and the consequences the stakeholders are involved in making the choices. Sufficient team diversity, enough people with different backgrounds, different understanding, different experience, so that people can contribute to new things to be done. Remember the difference between creativity and innovation? So if you don't remember, make a recall on it. Yeah. Ensure neither leader nor any member dominates. No one takes charge and control it. It needs to be shared with everyone else so everyone is comfortable to share their ideas. Maintain optimal team size, not too big, not too small, something that is okay for and is manageable. Introduce effective team structures. Who is supposed to be the leader or who is responsible for doing things or which areas are they supposed to work in? Techniques to improve team effectiveness. Number one is constructive conflict. Means to say you don't focus on the person, but rather you focus on the issue, and they need to take a look at the issue and try to solve it rather than try to condemn other people individually. Rules of brainstorming: speak freely. Yeah, if you don't speak freely, then you are unable to produce great ideas that perhaps could solve this the problem or try to achieve the objective that the team is trying to achieve. Don't criticize. Yeah, I mean to say that you don't make people feel down when they're trying to contribute something, because sometimes they're really shy. So everybody has the chance to speak. Provide as many ideas as possible. Yeah, give it out. So you just when you already have a lot of ideas, then you choose the best one. Yeah, build on others' ideas. You combine the ideas so they don't feel left out. So you combine the ideas and your ideas and other people's ideas, so it becomes something new that everyone has participated in. Evaluating brainstorming, its strength and weakness. I think you can read it here. I think it's really clear. Yeah. Electronic brainstorming. Electronic brainstorming is basically you use computers, so you don't really tell who you are. You become anonymous, so your ideas can be criticized. It's easy for you to criticize other people's work because you don't really have to face them face to face, or you listen to them or to hear them being unhappy or being mad because their ideas were commented. So it allows for people to freely comment without being socially responsible towards each other. Yeah. So it strengthens more creative ideas, minimal production blocking, evaluation, apprehension, or conformity problems. Relies on network computers to meet and share creative ideas. So you share there, but you don't know whose idea it is. And when at the same time you are the one sharing their idea, you don't people don't know who is the one sending it. Yeah. So for instance, everyone has this WhatsApp group, but they're using different numbers. So you don't know whose idea is which and which. So you are easily to share your ideas without feeling shame or being judged. And last one is nominal group technique. So this is is really lenient one, as in they can look silently and independently document their ideas that they put in writings or whatever, and then collectively describe these ideas to the other member without critique. So they don't really critique much, so they just show whatever they have and try to make people understand from their side what's going on, and silently and independently evaluate the ideas presented and choose one. So you can take a look at the diagram below here. You describe the problem, individual activity, write down possible solutions, yeah, whatever solution. So you just write them down, yeah. Team effectivity, possible solution, describe to others. You describe to other people, different than the computer one. You don't meet people, but here you meet other people as well. And individual activity, vote on solutions presented. So you choose the best way, the best way to do it, or the best solution to whatever issue that you guys are facing as a team. And that's the end for today's lecture. Yeah. So I hope that everyone here is clear. But in case, as always, you may ask question in the group and make sure that you interact well. Remember, because we learn about teams, do not be pressured to think that you're not important, or you think that you're embarrassed to comment or to say anything. It's time for you to shine as a student. Yeah, you cannot be always be what you call hiding behind anonymity. Anonymity is someone that I don't know. Please show yourself. Yeah. Please ask. Please comment. Please show your idea. Okay, in the WhatsApp group. So I see you guys there. And as always, give a like, subscribe, and make sure you put your names down there, groups as well as your metric number for attendance. See you guys.